Should make a start. Thank you very much for coming. This is the third and last in a series of lectures featuring an emerging generation of architects who are constructing their own new forms of practice. We have already heard from Swiss architect Taha F. and from Spanish architect Anton Garcia Abril, head of Ensemble Studio. Both lectures are available on the AA website in case you should have missed them. Both of those offices showed us how today, by engaging directly with the building process, an architect can still produce experimental and radical work. And this despite the suffocating grip that ever stricter building legislation and risk-averse contractors have on the building industry. Both lectures featured uncompromising yet pragmatic architects whose primary aim is to build and who succeed in doing so. But we all know that there is more to architecture than building buildings. Recent discourse may have been preoccupied with the discussion of technological change, namely the introduction of digital production tools into architectural practice. But while this is going on, another, and in my opinion, more significant digital revolution has quietly taken place. The increasing availability of information, and with it the return of historical awareness and curiosity. That the prevalence of Wikipedia, JSTOR, and Flickr in the long run might prove to be just as big a game changer as Rhino, Grasshopper, and Maya is already evidenced in the briefs of many AA units. History as a topic and a method has returned to the design studio in a big way. But when it comes to the architectural profession, most architects out there are simply content with just finding ways of integrating digital tools with their daily design work. While they may be more aware of historical precedent, only very few of them ever ask the right questions. How do you integrate history productively with practice? How do you create new forms of practice out of a dialogue with history rather than out of its denial? Two architects who do ask those questions are our guests tonight, Luc Merx and Christian Holl. Under the collective name Rococo Relevance, they engage with research and design work that oscillates between artistic practice, graphics, installation art, and product design. They are as much new ornamentalists as they are contemporary architects. Both are academics. Merx is a professor at the University of Technology in Kaiserslautern, Germany, as well as the head of the Maastricht Building Academy in Holland. Holl was most recently an assistant professor at the University of Stuttgart's Institute of Urbanism and has also taught at the universities of Darmstadt, Kaiserslautern, and Wuppertal. Christian Holl is an architect who writes, a rare thing these days. He was indeed editor of the Deutsche Bauzeitung and is a founding member of the publishing group Frei 04. Merx and his company Gagat International are the designers of the team. Their work has been exhibited across the world. To name a few, they featured in the V&A's Telling Tales exhibition of 2009, and more recently they were shown in the inaugural exhibition of Ron Eret's Holon Design Museum in Israel, and at Design Miami. They made installations for the historical Cowen Museum in Aachen and the exquisite Rococo masterpiece that is the Würzburg Residence. They have even produced an ornamental installation at the mothership of all white wall modernism, the Weissenhof Gallery. And most importantly, they count Brad Pitt as a fan of their work. I have to admit that I've met Luc and Christian before, and both times they were the only architects in a room full of art historians, always a good sign. It was at these meetings for people with slightly unhealthy ornamental obsessions where I detected how Luc and Christian's eyes lit up when we started arguing about 18th century stucco work in southern Bavaria. Now, any Dutch or German architect who has escaped the modernist brainwash and embraces the exuberance of the rocaille instead knows a thing or two about breaking taboos. And that is precisely what the two of them have come here to do. So without further ado, please welcome Luc Merx and Christian Holl.
Okay, so hello everybody. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for coming and thank you for the invitation and the possibility, I put it a bit like there, to introduce our project to you tonight. First of all, let me say that the project Rococo Relevance and Contingency of Design is a network of people. It's more than two of us. It's also other people, so that should be mentioned before. That's not only the work of the two of us. We want to present you some of the projects we realized of Contingency of Design, but this title is not only a title to sum up a few projects, but a kind of research project that combines both theoretical reflection and practice. In a short introduction, I would like first to explain you a little about the idea of Rococo Relevance and Contingency of Design, and then Luc will add some more aspects and show you some of the projects. With this research, we try to find out the potentials of architecture as a part of a cultural discussion and the power architecture can have, especially in regard to use in the use of historic references. First of all, the project started for us as a method to get a feeling for or to understand what history could mean in architecture. We noticed that there's only a few forms, a few buildings, or a few elements that normally are used as historical reference in architecture. But regarding all the richness of historical architecture, this is unsatisfactory, and we wondered what potential could be discovered if we would be free from the restrictions that seems to determine that architectural forms that are established. In other words, we noticed that there is a lot of taboos that bars us from using the forms history can offer us. Our idea is not only to solve any problems or to tell other people how to work or to design. Our ambition is to get some problems in a state that they can be discussed and to find ways and terms that might help to ask questions precisely. The most important question to us is what possibility of architecture is not used but could be helpful to get to know something on architecture. To get closer to the point, we have been concentrating on historical references of a period that seemed to be out of focus but has a lot close aspects to today's questions. And we concentrated on getting deeper in the question how the use of historical references is justified. We found out that in a lot of cases, history seems to be some kind of representation of a truth, that history is still something that, in following both Hegel and Marx, as well as Adorno and Horkheimer, is something that is not finished, but that can be completed. To have an idea of something that can be completed, you have to be sure that you are able to see the completed status. This completed or fulfilled status allows you to set limits in what in the present should be done or needn't to be done. It is an idea of being in some kind responsible, confronted with history, that you have obligations to act correctly and to design correctly. Your responsibility is to act in a manner that history can be fulfilled soon. In this regard, there's always both a truth of architecture and a truth of history. And this is the result. But we felt that the potential of architecture of design could be something else if we deny that there is a truth. If we don't measure architecture as something that only should fulfill historic inevitability, that should fulfill social or economic or urbanistic guidelines. We try to consider architecture as something that is not only a result of a social process, but that is also the condition that the social process can take place. We also don't think that there is an urbanistic truth that could determine architectural solutions. We deny, at least as an experiment, that there is a definition of the good city. What the city can be is not fixed before houses are built. In building houses, we decide on what city can be. According to Baudrillard, we want to find out what architecture could be as an object that exists besides its social reality, as an object that should be able to provoke its surrounding. To provoke its surrounding without resting in a state or in an attitude of provocation. We made the experiment to try what happens if we act as if there is no truth that lies behind everything that we see, to deny that appearances can be able to express a truth. As we know that we are not autonomous persons, that means that we have the way we look at things, we judge on them, is influenced by the limits and restrictions, by habits and taboos of our surrounding. We are searching also for the things we would not take into consideration as an option for design, for example, when we take part in a competition. We ask ourselves about historical references we would normally not use. We are looking for our own aversions concerning design. And then we have been searching for terms that would be able to describe our work and to find a way to set our work in relation to others. We have learned that design is a process of reducing options. At the end, you have to decide for a proposed solution. But if we do not consider architecture as a problem that has to be solved, there is no need to get straight to a solution that eliminates other options. We wondered if architecture could talk also on what is not realized, but part of what is or what can be realized. This led us to the term contingency, which we found could be able to describe this idea of openness. It is a term we took by Richard Rorty. Of course, it's not only him to use this term, but Rorty uses contingency in relation to cultural, social, and political aspects as a whole. This, we found, is very inspiring. Contingency means more to us than only a term that can describe the quality of our work. It's also a term that allows us to get closer to discussions in other fields and to refer them back to architecture. Let me tell you now a little how we understand this. Contingency can be described as a term that marks the field between necessity and what is arbitrary. It is a term that does not claim something, but that opens possibilities. But it opens possibilities on a very precisely way. We think that you should be aware that everything that you do is only a little part of what can be done. Contingency describes the field of possible ways to go without constraining someone to do so, but to offer it as one possible way. It gives us the freedom to talk on our ideas without reducing the freedom of others that look at our work. It's a possibility to ask for the potential of historical references without saying these are more important than others and without reducing them to the meaning that is established. There's at least two ways to understand contingency. If you talk about what can be possible, it can also be something that lies in the future. I think this is the way, for example, Ernst Bloch uses contingency. Man, he says, is the creature that still has a lot to expect. Contingency describes the multitude of changes and development that still can be realized. It's a kind of hope on a better life that might come true one fine day. The real genesis, Bloch says, is not at the beginning but at the end. It is something that is still bound to come. This also means that the world is not perfect yet and there's a hope that future will bring improvements. But once fulfilled, it will be the end of history. But we want to contingency to be understood as a term that is related to the present. I would like to explain a bit closer the idea of contingency as used by Rorty, so you might be able to understand better what is important for us. Rorty claims that there's no truth out there, or at least there's no possibility for us to catch a truth as an eternal power or a truth that exists after we are gone. The only way to talk about us and the people around us is to use the possibilities we have. This is the basis of the way we live together, but this basis will never be fixed. This is why there's a permanent process between self-description of the individual and its relation to the community, however you might want to call it. And this balance is always a very fragile one. Routine and a fixed vocabulary makes it impossible to react on changes in the relation between people and our surrounding. That prevents us in experiencing new options and in asking if we take everything in consideration that could be important for us. In claiming a truth out there, however you make it legal, also to hurt others in the name of this truth. For Rorty, the idea of the liberal is to avoid cruelness, and he pleads for an aesthetic culture that does not claim that there's a true wall behind the painted wall. We think that architecture still does not use the possibilities to discover its potentials as aesthetic culture, neither concerning its new instruments nor in comparison with other cultural practice. Let me give you some hints on what that could mean. For example, the term of landscape can be regarded as a construction or an entity that never can be finally fixed. Landscape as term can be regarded as a part of a language that helps us to take for real what is happening around us and to describe what we want our surrounding to be. But to describe what we want to be or we want it to be, we have to imagine reality in possible realities. We make visible what could be done and what should be avoided. We need the picture and the imagination of what we intend to realize and also of what we dream of to be able to talk on it. And without this talking, we would not be able to realize anything in context that can be described as landscape. In this respect, also artwork on landscape is a medium to talk on our relation to each other. So far, you might not have a clue why this lecture is called Opulent Decay. The project Rococo Relevance is also a project to think about things we might have lost. and to talk about qualities that might be useful for discussions today. It is not that we want to go back to times that are gone. Of course, that is not possible. And we don't want to reduce a complexity that is gone, but we think that wondering what quality it had could be worth to ask questions on what we are doing today and to find new complexities. The first hint is about Acadia. Acadia, as it was understood in history, was not a really existing place. Of course, there is the place called Acadia in Greece, but the topos in painting and writing was not that part of Greece. Actually, it was a space that did not exist in reality. It existed as a real virtual space. It was a space where you could place messages in a very sophisticated code. It was a space to talk both about death and decay and eternity. The word you could read on the stone below, et in Arcadio ego, can be read both as the presence of death in Arcadia and a dead man talking to the person viewing the picture saying, I am in Arcadia. The landscape is part of a space that is more complex than it would be without the hints of cryptic persons finding cryptic tomes with cryptic writings on it. It's a manner to talk about what moves us, both death and life, both fear and hope, not only to celebrate arts, but also to fix fears and to avert threats. And it is a way to talk about what the good life could be. This is not only a virtual world in paintings or writings, but also in landscape parks. In this sense, you might say that a landscape park is both a virtual and a real place. I think it is important to think about the meaning of construct places and construct landscapes as a part of us talking to each other. Also our cities and the pictures we connect with the word city, spaces with a virtual component of what they could be without us being aware of it. I think a great lack in today's talking on architecture is that we don't talk on what could be realized but needn't to be realized. That we can use pictures and virtuality to talk about present and to find a way to describing ourselves in inspiration. The result of this lack is a kind of being fixed on a picture of architecture that exists in its true and mere qualities only in the untouched state, when it is finished and before people could have the possibility to use it. This is a present example, and I'll show you an example you might know very well. It's the design showing the Bank of England from 1830, and it was made 3 years before the bank was completed. It was made to celebrate its greatness, and it says there's qualities that will rest also if a long time will go on it, and it will become a ruin. And you can imagine that today no architect would make a design on his building 3 years before it's completed. But also the decay and the dirt is part of the quality of architecture, and it could also be a quality to give us the possibility to understand what people could be. The decay makes something else visible and something else possible if we don't believe anymore that it's the baddest way we have to expect. There is a quality of cities and architecture missing if we only are fixed and concentrated on the reality and the mere status of not being touched. Our idea is also to learn something about the meanings of symbols and signs when we release them from the surrounding that keeps them resting in peace. Then we can find out what they could mean to us and if they still mean anything to us. At last, I hope one example could show a bit closer what that means. This is the picture of the Mole Antonelliana in Turin. Its height now is 168 meters. It's completed in 1880 by the architect Antonelli. But first it was planned as a synagogue only 47 meters high. Antonelli changed the plans permanently during the construction, first on about 100 meters, then on 147, 153, and finally it ended up on 168 meters. And in the end, it was no more a synagogue, but a sign for the town, only that no one could say what it stands for. And then it became a museum of the Risorgimento. But Antonelli also found ways of new combinations of temple and dome variations he integrated in the building, that each of them made something different than it would have been as a single quotation. The meaning of them changed permanently, not only because of strange composition, but also in combination with an architect's strange drive to make the building always higher. For Nietzsche, this is an example for what he calls decadence. Decadence means for him something that contains both denial and affirmation without dissolving them. Decadence means that there is creation and destruction close to each other. Decadence means a way to express decay and to get beyond of it. It is a strategic way to make things visible and points them out in their inner complexity and ambiguity. And to get to this inner complexity, you cannot deny nor the ugly, nor the beauty, nor the decay, nor the rise. The only way to make it possible to talk on them is a way of an ironic phrase that makes it impossible to rest on fixed meanings. In this sense, Nietzsche is immoral, in the sense that he seeks for something beyond moral, or that can't be said if you are restricted by moral. Truths are illusions, but we forget that they are illusions, he said. They are like metaphors that lost their power. The task of the artist, as Nietzsche says, is to find new meanings for metaphors, to prevent them from getting rigid, to prevent them from getting terms with fixed meanings. That is the fantastic point on the Mole Antonelliana, that it was built further when people were thinking it is finished. It is a kind of Dionysian flush that can't be reached only on an intellectual, only on a symbolistic, only on a moralistic way. It needs the physiological aspect. It needs the physiological aspect for not being something transcendental, and I guess that is the same point that also for Rorty is always very important, to prevent us from believing that there is a truth out there and that we have to follow this truth. Nietzsche found in this building, the Mole Antonelliana, with an ironic and polemic undertone, a symbol of the modern. And by the way, for him, modern was more close to the Baroque than to Classicism or Renaissance. It is a way to come to the parts of human beings that are covered by moralistic talking, by taboos and aversions, and to come to complexity of what man can be. This leads back to Rorty and the idea of the painted wall that no more covers a true wall. We think that the surface as an architectonic medium should be regarded as a more complex conglomerate also of meaning that only a structure or a kind of pureness that is an imagination of the idea of a building that does exist or essentially exists only as an idea. This is a building for a family in Belgium by Gillette. The problem of the discussion on architecture or the way it is published and sold is that it shows architecture not as a real physical object, but as an idea of a pure object that reflects a world where you can believe in a truth of a pure architecture. With this idea of a truth, you get blind for the multitude and variety of the history, the variety of architecture, and you can't get personally involved in the work of architecture. This is what we are seeking for, a personal way to architecture. We want to get involved to it, and we don't want to judge it in relation to an idea of an architectonic truth, because we don't know which right we could have to claim any truth. This is why decay and ruins is an important element of history to us, because it does not only talk on decay, but it gets us involved in the idea of what we could find in the world to get in contact with others, to get always new ideas of reality and an imagination of possibilities, of contingency, and of the way people could think or feel. And we think that architecture could be a very powerful instrument to learn a lot about us, as long as we don't believe that it represents a truth out there. So far, this was my part, and I give now to Luc.
I will go on with with a slide that shows a screenshot from Quake. The computer was a starting point for our research on 18th century design. Not just architecture, but also the art and objects, object design. What's important for us is that I need to say it, even if everybody will know it. If you start to render, you first define the volumes, and then you start when you're mapping. It's always important to create the illusion of a spatial of a spatial illusion in the kind of maps you choose. For example, bricks in the masonry, or marble, or the grain of wood. That kind of materials are preferred in rendering because they suggest a speciality. Another aspect that's important is in this image is that the decay, the difference between the idea of architecture and reality becomes very important. Very important when you try to create the illusion of reality in a rendering. That's the base for what I'm going to show in the rest of the lecture. It's our whole interest in 18th century is based in this in the reflection over our tools. This is an image that shows a part of Maria Steinbach, a church in southern Germany. Many of the examples I'll show are from southern Germany. It's clear that if you look at the geometry and of the illusion of material. It's stucco lustro. I don't know stucco. What's no? Is it? Yes. and it's a very thin illusion of marble. And again, you see that there is this illusion of a three-dimensional structure in a very thin layer of stucco. Then there is another aspect that seems to be important for me. We'll see later on when we show our own projects why that is the federation. This is a. Another image that shows, it's a pity that the reproduction is not very good, but here you can see the material in this trompe-l'œil is based on the imitation of the wood, and again you see this suggestion of a three-dimensional material on the construction, and this construction is not. Not abstract, not like in an architectural drawing, but it's the difference between the idea of the construction and its reality that makes it real, and then this kind of elements and the dirt. So that's there is a link between decay. And dirt and realism. It's an important tool when you're trying to let things look real. This is a drawing by Andrea Pozzo. What's interesting about this drawing is that it shows. That in fact shows a three-dimensional image. It's an altar that's thought to be seen from there, and the result is a spatial image. As you can see, the backside is very rough. That's something. There is again a link with the computer. when you're making a rendering, you need another kind of efficiency as when you're building. The backside of what I'm doing isn't interesting. It's I'm just interested in what I see. And there, I think that's a point where we can learn a lot from late Baroque and Rococo. And this focusing on the efficiency of the visual aspects of architecture. This is a dome. It's a painted dome again by Andrea Pozzo in the Jesuiten church in Vienna. This is the same dome from the other side. The last images I showed from Andrea Pozzo are mainly focusing on a perfect illusion. These images are prints, French prints. The left one from Jean Beret, the right one from Watteau. They are based on a long tradition of the grotesque. And what is interesting about them is that they are not not trying to create an architectural a perfect spatial illusion. They are playing with the with the surface of the paper. They like Hermann Bauer arguments in his book Rokai. Are they part of the frame of the image? The frame grows into the center from the image, but there are many aspects that belong to the grotesque that move to the center too. This is very important for us. This ambiguous situation that is the result. It's not clear if it's real or just ornament. It's this ambivalence of figuration that is at the same time and that makes clear that it is ornament, or that it's painted, and that is not not searching for reality. There's an image that shows a print by Juste Aurel Maisonnier. Here you can see it very clearly, despite of the geometrical motifs that are important for us as a reference. You can see very clearly how he uses the surface of the paper to start his play with the depths of the virtual space. The Rokai, the main motif of 18th century design, is interesting on the one hand as an ornament, but as we saw in the drawing by Maisonnier, it's also if you look at it as a spatial concept, it can be much more than just an ornament. It can also be a spatial utopia. And as we will see, it is always thought like that. What's important for us in the use of the Rokai in interior design is the density of the spaces. You have the possibility to zoom in. It's not like the white walls that are dominant in our surrounding at this moment. Architecture has another detail. If you look at the system of the rocaille, in which the rocaille is integrated, you see that that there is a plinth and that architecture reacts on the scale of the user. That there is a very complex play with illusions like mirrors or images, and all these elements are similar to the prints I showed, not just just pure illusion, but they are always playing with the surface. Point at their virtuality. This is a rocaille. As an example of the way it melts with its with architectural ornaments. You see, this is another aspect that is very important for us in 18th century design: the slurring of definitions. Excuse me, I need to. Now I'll show some examples of the rocaille as a spatial concept, as a spatial utopia. It's very interesting. It's not really clear if these images are thought to be real prototypes for an architecture that can be realized. It's if you look at Meissonier, it's rather clear that he makes a difference between his prints and his designs. But in the 18th century, this changes on the base of the prints. Mainly in Germany, designers start to make this kind of porcelain figures. This is by Johann Wilhelm Lanz. And here you see that two-dimensional image becomes a spatial model. And what's even more interesting, that it becomes architecture. For example, here in Opolding, what I like the most about this one is that you can see this the self-similarity of the rocaille. If you look at the details, it's a giant ornamented rocaille. Oliver sees it different, but that's I think he sees it wrong. That's another aspect that's very important for if you look at the rocaille, it has no scale. It is comparable with the computer, with the space in the in a modeling program. It becomes its relationship. It becomes its scale in the context. That means that it's that this context is very important. It's very important that it the designs become real. One of the things I've been talking about is the dirt and the decay. Another aspect is the scale of the design. I'll go on now. This image, this is one of the images I love the most. It's by Johan Esaias Nilsson from Augsburg. Augsburg was an important center for the production and retail of prints. Nilsson, it's obvious. the geometrical forms. It's clear why they are interesting for us. But what is more important in this image is that it's the decay that causes the ornamental forms. The reason for the ornament is the Ruinesque. The whole 18th century is in the whole 18th century the ruinesque is an important topic. I show some prints of Piranesi, belong date to the ones that are gone now. What I like about this image is the strange situation of the destroyed temple and the Baroque church that is built inside, and the result is a hybrid that is that it's more than just a temple or just a church. And it's mainly interesting how the Roman rests, the Roman ruins add something to the church that makes the church more important than she would be without them. What's interesting about this image is that you see the height of the ground level. And here you I love this image because Piranesi draws on the one hand a simple cut through a ruin he has been analyzing. So on the one hand he is just documenting what he finds, but then below the level he starts to reconstruct the cave of the this Roman cave. I just saw some other examples to so that you see that there is a very big variety in forms that are dealing with decay. This is Le Désert de Rey near Paris. And this is Zwiefalten, a church in southern Germany. It's the whole theme of that church is decay. Every fresco and every detail is loaded with a symbolic that has to do with decay. And this is an artificial ruin, a theater in Sorparay near Bayreuth. There is another kind of motif that is called Urskokai by Hermann Bauer. It's not just the Ruinesque. Sometimes it's mixed with this topic of the Ruinesque, but it's different. It's the earth modeled in a way that it's designed, but at the same time it's a very subtle modification of reality. These are artificial rocks by Georges Louis Le Rouge. They are interesting when we're talking about reality. And this is an Urskokai in Versailles. You can see that it's not just just a copy of nature. It's the projection of ideals of ideal forms on nature. So as you can see, it's also a huge rokai. And then another motif is nature. on the left, it's a bosquet. As you can see, it has its reason in the whole context of the architecture. But if you look at it in detail, it's totally fragmented. It's just a clump of natural motifs. On the right side, you see a print by Jean Pillemont. He designed many invented flowers. This is from a series called Fleur Ideale. And this is a terrain by Justo Real Maisonnier. Here you see again natural motifs. What's interesting about this is that they are highly accurate in their design, in the way he copies the original, but by the use of silver, they are confronted with an abstraction. And also something else that's important for us is that you again can that you see again the importance of slurring the parts to one whole. There is a bowl, a tureen, this whole consists of three parts. Then I'll show a last image, a last reference. This is in the Hameau in Chantilly. What I like about this is that that you see in this detail, you can see it in this detail. It's a totally artificial building. It just simulates a grown structure. What you see is just a simulation of time. And of a usage of a grown architecture. And now I'll start to show our projects. The first project is rather old. It's designed in 1996. It was a temporary exhibition in St. Veit, St. Veit an der Glan in a factory that by Coop Himmelblau, and what we were interested in was to confront an architecture, a very rough outside of this exhibition or of this infrastructure. It was in fact an infrastructure for a huge event that took place in one night, and at the inside it's very compared to the outside, it's perfect. And we used, it's also important, for us it was also important how we deal with the context. The whole project focuses on the efficiency of design. We try to get the logic of computers, of rendering into a real project. This is an installation we designed for Rotterdam, and here we were interested in the illusion. It has to do with the drawings I showed, with the images I showed, the images of Andrea Pozzo. It has to do with the Quadratura painting in the work of Pozzo. And here it's again, we were again interested in the efficiency of, it's also rather old, this installation. So it was a rendered structure that, of course, is much cheaper than if we would have realized it in it's three-dimensional. like in the other installation, it was important for us in this case too to confront the reality of of the prints with a roughness in the way they are with the roughness of the place where this installation was presented, and also the you can see it here. It's very roughly done, but we were sure that ornament accepts a bigger tolerance than abstraction. If we aim, if our aim is to get as nearby to the rendering as possible, to a computer rendering, we need to be much more precise than in the case of an ornamented wallpaper. So that's this precision is one of our topics. This is the second installation we did. This is the base for a second installation we did for that same exhibition. Here it is again. What's mainly interesting is that these wax models have many mistakes, and they it was important for us to see how they if that's a problem. In this case, it's another installation. Here we were interested in the traces of the production as a second ornamental level. I go through these slides rather quickly just to show. This is these tiles are designed from Mosa. It's a Dutch company. And we were searching for mistakes in the glazing of those tiles. Mosa is a company with a long modernistic tradition, and they their aim is always to get as close to perfection as possible, and we were searching for the ornamental potentials of physical processes in the glazes. Now show a project on which we are working with the textile institute in Aachen. First some references. What's interesting about these images is that that you see this is in Zwiefalten again. This perforation of surface allows a layering of space. Here you can see the illusion of space, a space that is projected in front of the real space, and the result is that you have both. You have the space that is showed in the fence, and at the same time in the lattice, and at the same time you have the background. You see it also in the bobbin lace. This is an example from Italy. What we are fascinated of is this combination of ornament and construction. It's identical, and it's not the ornament is not an application anymore. But in the case of lace or of the lattice, it's identical. This is again from Augsburg. A part of a table decoration from Bernhard Heinrich Weihe. And now I show some studies from Lace. We have been playing with the, we have changed the scale of the Bowen Lace. It's done with cable wire. But we were interested in the in the ornamental potential of it. And of course, two in the constructional possibilities of the lace. And then the result of this was this object. It's three-dimensional lace, and it's what we are interested in at the moment is to find the to define the width between the the definition of these structures and the possibilities to define the construction and making them by hand. It's impossible to create and to design something like this if you don't do it by hand. You need to it's too too complex, but that's something we are developing with the ITA in Aachen. This is a project from 2000. It's an installation for the Gartensaal, garden hall in the residency of Balthasar Neumann, and we have been. Yeah, this was a reference for the outside of this installation. It's designed in cooperation with students from the Technical University in Darmstadt. And again, it was very important to produce it, not just to design. It was the first time they used the computer. That was an image of the entrance, and the inside is referring to the those computer prints to those prints, 18th century prints. It shows this was the inside. It's a changing structure. excuse me. I need to go back. Now I'll show a lamp, a chandelier designed for MGX in Belgium. The starting point was this painting by Rubens, The Fall of the Damned. And another starting point was the baroque sculpture that goes back to Gian Bologna, the tormented bodies of in the marble sculptures, and it was like in many of our projects, we were dealing with personal taboos, and one of those taboos was figuration. So we forced to produce a figurative lamp. Here you can see that, like in the in those baroque sculptures, we are also dealing with functional aspects like the construction and like the lighting that needs to be optimized. And this was the result. And for the same company, for MGX, we designed a system of proportions, micromegas, that is the base for the last projects I will show now. First, Sterko MGX. In the case of the fall of the damned, it was a big problem that for us as architects that that you're designing an object without a context. That was the starting point for this project. If you look at decoration from the 18th century, in this case by Cuvier in the residency of Würzburg, or this is also a great interior. It's in the Schätzler Palais in Augsburg again. What's really fascinating is that the interiors get a density that that is disappeared afterwards. It was our aim to in our installations we always had the problem that we needed to start at point zero. So it was impossible for a temporary installation to develop a system like this for a temporary installation. So it was the aim to create a system of proportions that allows us to combine the elements we design later on in new installations to reach a growing complexity. This shows the components of a design by Maisonnier, by Justorel Maisonnier, for the Salon Sartoriska. and this is our design for the stucco system. These are just two parts, but what is shown in this image is that you can use them as single parts, that you can combine them to groups, and that you can that they are at the same time part of a system, of an infinite system. There are two proportions. You have a square and a rectangle, and it's based on the golden ratio. That allows us to combine the elements in different scales. And here you can see what happens if we base our design on those measurements. They always fit, and that's yeah, this shows the production is not important, but this is something this image shows prototype we realized, and here you can see that we again try to use the polygons of the computer model for as an ornament to give it more detail and the layers of the production process. And for us, it was very important to use the aging of the material, but it was a problem we have been discussing a lot. We like that that it's almost impossible to control the color. We like the plastic as a material that that is aging and that changes during the time. This is a presentation of the system in a show in Brussels. And this is now show some extra panels we are working on at this moment. This is a mirror again, and it's try to combine the fall of the damned with the stucco system. And here you can see how it works in different scales. So here it's combined with the other mirror from the Stecco system. Now I'll show the last project. It was designed for a competition, and it's I won't explain the whole project, but we try to get our two-dimensional system, and until now it was this micromegas system was related to the surface, and now we try to get it to create a three-dimensional structure out of it. And another aspect that was important in the context of this lecture is that that this modular system for us is a kind of reverse Ruinesque process. You're adding parts, but you don't need to add them until they are a finished whole. They still can be a fragment, and this was the result. It's designed for a temporary exhibition space, and this exhibition space exists only contains the images and the frames. That's everything that's left from the architecture, and that was.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Hold on.
Just a really quick one, actually. That's the visual, I presume. Will that be built or?
No, it won't be built. We lost the competition, like always. The winner produced modernistic crap.
I mean, I presume it's obviously an issue of budget and all that, and it's much.
No, that was not a problem.
No, not this, but generally, instead of it, it's not easy at all. But it's kind of easier to realize objects. Or
we left the roof away, so it's much cheaper than the other version. That.
But generally, you know, on a more serious note, so you're doing the lampshades and you're doing these stucco things, which I love. They're great. But is the ambition to do kind of bigger projects and do translate this in a even more architectural sort of output?
We're not just architects, but it's it is our aim to test what we are to test our research and architectural projects. It took a long time to analyze those references, and then we started to do those installation we showed and prototypes Yeah, for us it was very important to get this possibility to produce objects like the fall of the damned, but they are still strange kind of objects. They are for luxury market, so it's still something in between. But we are working on other projects. There is a small Rococo pavilion. Without an interior, and we will we have the commission to design that interior. It's our aim to test it in architecture in the future.
And one more thing, okay, you're talking about that one of your headers was pictorial space. You're talking about the density of spatial ornaments and that creates and. I'm just wondering, your images, they're completely abstract, aren't they? The ones you're using. And might there be a way of...
You mean
your project, apart from the falling of the dam, just a kind of very clear image, but is there might there be a way of extending the imagery you're using? Like, for example, in a Baroque church, that wouldn't be in the story told for the illiterate people. Or what would that kind of imagery, what could that be nowadays?
There is a difference between what we have been shown and real projects. The projects I've shown are most of them are prototypes, they are not thought to be part of reality. They are incomplete. They don't have the complexity we aim to reach at the end. So that means that it's also okay. That's still okay to show that there are to reduce them to the aspects we are doing research on. I think that's the reason why the images are the way they are. and it, of course, it's our aim to reach a higher level of complexity, and that means that. But decay is just one of the topics we have been concentrating on in this lecture. Maybe it's not even the most important topic. I try to show the complexity of those different themes we are trying to reflect.
And I think another aspect of that is that we understand figuration as not something only showing people or figures. Then it's also something that allows us to as metaphors for something that is open to associations that an audience or people may have. And in this sense, the pictures are not real pictures, but they are not abstract. For us, they're not abstract at all, but we don't want to fix them on meanings that we determine. And I think maybe that is also a very important aspect for what figuration can mean.
There are two questions.
We're fighting for questions here, but I thought it was really interesting that you started and finished with an image that's like a project quite similar to the first project that you had in terms of the scale of it. Mm-hmm. But it's, you know, the first project, the exhibition, was quite minimalist, and this one is quite, you know, busily and complicated and ornamental. And I was just wondering what the interest in complexity is all about. Like, is it just about the inspiration pool you're drawing from is really the Rococo and stuff like that? Or is it because you feel like there's something fundamentally beautiful or human in complexity and the need to have aesthetic complexity?
The starting point for us is that we feel there is lacking something. We don't want to replace an architecture that aims to be as abstract as possible, but we think we are missing many possibilities at this moment, and it's for me as an architect, it's mainly interesting to find what is left over. That's the starting point, I think when you're digging into a topic. At a special point, you're infected, and that's then it's hard to see hard to separate between what is just based in this personal fascination that has to do with this interest in 18th century design. And what is what has a broader meaning? So it's the most important is that we're trying to focus on possibilities that of the computer that seem to be left over in the last years. I think it's changing at this moment, but when we started at the end of the 90s. we were really disappointed how the computer was used. The promises didn't become reality. It was a bit frustrating to see that architecture was still very abstract that tools like mapping they had an influence on realized architecture, but for me it was always disappointing to compare what is realized today with all the possibilities of the computer, and to look at 18th century architecture designed without a computer, and to have the feeling that it's a better answer on the potential of our tools than what we are doing with them. We bring the solutions at this moment. We're mainly defining questions, I think.
Mm. And I think an important aspect is also that you don't have to reduce complexity of the way these projects are produced. And for us, also important is the complexity of how it is used and which pictures and imaginations you can associate with them, and how it can change while it is used, or how other people in other contexts are seeing it, or what their imaginations. So this is kind of a complexity that has also to do with a point of what you could combine with them. And it's not only the complexity of production that is important for us.
One more question? Yeah. Hi. So it seems to me that your experiments are dealing with patterns and the architecture of patterns. Would you say that's true?
It's at least one of our topics.
Well, it's one of the problems. Yeah. So my question is, when you're dealing with patterns, that you're kind of dealing with two-dimensional patterns, for instance, mirroring, translating, sliding, what have you. How come you haven't delved into the realm of three-dimensional patterns, or kind of using the computer to have more complex like algorithms for patternology?
Yeah, I think we just didn't want to start there. Of course, we could have started with those complex patterns. It's a growing project, and our aim is to concentrate on leftovers like this. I mean, it's important that you know that we come from a different context. I think a lot of what we are interested in is much more common here than in the context in which we have been designing. Topics like decay and the dirt simulation of decay, or also this hybrid reality of the grotesque and figuration. We are doing research in a rather broad. We spread our interests instead of focusing on topics like three-dimensional patterns. But if we could integrate that in all those other themes you're interested in the project would be.
So do you think that your project would eventually develop into that realm, or?
Yeah, partially. At the same time, I think we will still work with two-dimensional projections. I don't see it as a need to focus on the maximum possible. we are interested in all the things in between, and to there are many of the topics we are interested in that played a role in the discussion about architecture for a very short time, and then there was something new that was more more advanced. That at least that's our
vision.